Hi everyone, my name is Stefan, I'm a pulmonologist. In this video, I'd like to discuss about this article that I've recently read in the European Respiratory Journal. So it's going to be just a couple of key points and my opinion about this article. You can see it right here if you want to access it. The authors were here, Mark Jones and Martin Kolb. So the article was called Repeat Bronchoalveolar Lavage in Idiopathic Pulmonary Fibrosis, Proceed with Caution. So don't worry, this video won't get very, very technical. So if you're watching this as a person who hasn't been trained in medical research, that's okay. That's fine. I'm going to explain the concepts as I go along, so hopefully to get more people interested in medical research and pulmonology, respiratory disease, because it is really fascinating. So idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis is a condition that's really, really serious. So it's on par with most cancers. Even though it's not called cancer, it is just as bad. So it is scarring of the lungs, that's what fibrosis means, pulmonary fibrosis, that begins somewhere in the periphery of the lung, and it basically just continues on and just incorporates most of the lung, and the lungs become hardened. It's harder and harder to breathe for these patients who suffer with idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. And basically the life expectancy is 3 to 5 years from the moment patients are diagnosed with IPF. So it's a terrible, terrible condition. It's called idiopathic because we don't know exactly what causes it. So that's the medical term for unknown cause, undetermined cause. Bronchoalveolar lavage is a procedure. It's a bronchoscopic procedure, so a camera test for the lung, in which we perform this lavage, which is a lung wash. So a bit of saline is introduced in one segment of the lung, and basically that saline liquid is pushed in and then collected back again. It's aspirated, and we look at it in the lab to see what kind of cells are in the lungs, what kind of biomarkers, proteins are there. And that gives us a lot of indication about what's going on in the lungs, what sort of inflammation is there, what other cells are there, what sort of gene expression can be seen in cells collected from the lavage fluid. So it's really, really a useful procedure, and it is sometimes performed in IPF patients at the moment of diagnosis, but as you will see here in medical research. So this study, this article basically, was a commentary on a study. Don't worry about these terms. I will explain everything as I go along. So a study on a commentary on an early phase study of this inhaled drug, which carries a code name at this stage, in patients with IPF. So this is the article publishing the results of the study, if you want to look at that. And basically, a phase one study looks, or phase one and 2A study, basically they look at the safety, tolerability, and pharmacokinetics of certain medications. I will explain all these terms. So phase one refers to first in human studies. So basically we have healthy volunteers who are given an experimental drug that has only been tested in animals prior to being given to humans. So we don't know what might happen generally. We have an idea based on the research that has been done, but of course there are many, many unknowns. And phase 2A basically refers to a proof of concept study. So we're looking at whether this drug has a chance of working. Does it reach its intended target in the lungs, for example? And that's what we look at: safety, tolerability, and pharmacokinetics. Pharmacokinetics is basically just a term that refers to how the drug behaves in the body, how the drugs move around the body. So basically we're looking at whether the drug, as we inhale it, does it reach the lung in sufficient concentration. This study, because it was a first in human study and then a 2A study, so it included healthy volunteers in its initial parts, but then it was basically an IPF study of 24 patients randomized to this drug with the code name or placebo for 14 days. So randomization means that in a double-blind study, so what happens is that the investigator, the researcher, and the patient, neither of them knows what drug they're on. So they don't know whether they're on this one or this one. So they don't know whether they're on the active compound or the inactive placebo. Two bronchoscopies had to be performed. So one was done at day one. So this is basically just prior to starting dosing with the drug or the placebo. And then the drug was given for 14 days. And then there was another bronchoscopy with a lavage performed at day 14 to see what had happened. So basically at day one, we get a baseline of what's going on in the lungs. We take a sample at baseline. And then at 14 days after dosing, we see what happened with the drug. Did it reach the lung in sufficient quantity? Were the targets of the drug engaged? And we look at this information by collecting a second sample, which is logical, of course. Now, this study met its endpoints and it is proceeding to phase 2B, which is an efficacy study. So this is where we really get into the efficacy of the drug. Does it really work? Because these numbers are quite low. So we need a bit more information to put the drug on the market because it really needs to have a good effect. The only problem that was mentioned in this commentary was the fact that one patient who was involved in the study passed away due to an acute exacerbation of IPF, so AE-IPF. These are very, very serious occurrences. They can occur even outside medical research. IPF patients sometimes get these flare-ups of their disease with lots of inflammation in their lungs, and they are very, very deadly, and we don't know very well what triggers them. However, sometimes they can be triggered by invasive procedures, such as a lung biopsy. We know that. But in this study, it happened 2 days after a second bronchoalveolar lavage. Now, the only problem here is that it's, of course, a very, very serious event. And the question here is not really whether the drug caused this, because it was found that it didn't seem likely to be the drug, but it is potentially due to the second bronchoalveolar lavage procedure. And this, of course, brings into question what we do next in future trials, because it's a very, very serious occurrence to have patients dying as part of research. It's not ideal, of course. So the trial overall, however, was a success because the drug can progress in future studies and it might actually do a lot of good in the future. However, we need to think about this small risk of acute exacerbations of IPF because they are very, very serious occurrences. And overall, the BAL procedure is very safe in IPF patients. We do it as routine to diagnose the disease. However, what we don't do as routine is to do it again. So we don't necessarily do it twice in IPF patients. Generally, it's done at the beginning and then patients are diagnosed and then they continue. However, the safety of the repeat procedure is not very clear. There's limited literature published about this. Double BAL studies are very, very common as a design in early phase IPF studies because we need to really know what's going on at baseline and then we give the drug and then to see what happens at the end. So the double BAL design does provide very important data for drug development, but really we need to be very careful about participant selection and we need to explain the risks very, very well at consent because as you know, when you take part in a study, you need to be signing an informed consent. So you need to really understand what you're getting yourself into. And we need as researchers to probably very carefully select who we're putting on early phase trials to mitigate this risk as much as possible. Now, this is just a comment on this article. I would like to hear what are your thoughts about this? What do you think? Do you think the risks are too great? Do you think we need to do research in a different way? How would you mitigate these risks? Because we still probably need to research these early drugs to see whether they're safe. How would we do it? Do you have any ideas for alternative study design options? How could we get away without doing these repeat procedures? If you have any comments, do leave them in the section below. And if you like these videos, please subscribe to the channel. I'll see you in the next videos. All the best.